Many of you know my husband Doug, and he has been having the privilege of being with you as you were in a transition time. And while you were in transition, so was Albany, and so was Kaiser, which is where I have been spending my time, as well as Bedford. And so I ask your continued prayers. Albany and Kaiser have called in pastors, and soon we'll install them. And Bedford is not far behind. I know this is always an interesting process and sometimes brings up all sorts of things, but we are so glad for the opportunity to be in the conversation with you as we as a whole church move together. And I bring you greetings on behalf of the Christian Church in Oregon and Southwest Idaho, the Christian Church Disciples of Christ in the United States of Canada. That's a long...
Amen.
Amen, yeah. That's a long thing. No, I actually am glad that we have that long sentence to bring greetings because you are partnered with congregations all over North America and indeed the world, as Week of Compassion Sunday reminds us. But in this regional church in Oregon and Southwest Idaho, where I've been privileged with Doug to serve for almost 16 years with you, which seems hardly possible, but is true. We came and you were 32 congregations and now you are 45. We are in 17 counties in Oregon and we are in 5 counties in Idaho, and we speak now 3 languages instead of 1. We speak English and Spanish and Chukis. We have 3 congregations now who speak Chukis, a Micronesian language, who came to the United States and who have found in the Midwest the Disciples of Christ, and they told their friends, you know, you should check out the Christian Church because they have room for us and they have been a partner with us. And so indeed, one of the ways that they knew us was from hurricane recovery in Micronesia. And they said, you know, they pay attention to their partners. I also bring you greetings from Doug. Personally, he is at St. John's Community Church today as they, a new church start in North Portland, are entering a partnership with a Methodist congregation with which they will share space. They said, why should we each pay all that money to have a building when we could share the building and thereby free more money for mission? So it's an interesting day. I also bring you greetings from V. Nguyen, who is the director of Week of Compassion, and his associate Carolyn Hamilton Arnold, who was here last week, actually, last weekend. And in a strange sort of way, Carolyn was at the middle school youth retreat that is finishing about now with Youth Sunday at Albany. Because Carolyn wanted so much to speak with the middle school kids, she made a video and she spoke directly to them yesterday during the keynote time, and told them a story that was so moving and so powerful that the kids were just like this, hearing about compassion. And so it is really a privilege to bring greetings from all of those people. When Carolyn was here last week, she was on the phone a lot on Monday morning when we were having an event and had to keep excusing herself. And finally I said, what's going on? And she said, well, I'm setting up a station at the Chico Christian Church because of the Oroville Dam and because all those people being displaced. Chico's becoming a station of welcome and of respite. So I had to get that to all happen. So she was on the phone and I finally said, what do you do when you're not responding to disaster? What do you do for fun? And she says, I watch the Weather Channel. She gets in front of it, and she gets ready for us. And so as we enter into a time of thinking about compassion and encountering the scriptures read today, I would ask you to join me in a moment of prayer. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O God who made me, and who holds me fast. Amen. Week of Compassion actually began over 70 years ago. It wasn't a well thought out plan. It just happened. There was a huge earthquake in China, and we had mission folks there who knew the people who built hospitals who had been present in China. And when this huge earthquake displaced so many people, they quickly got in touch with their US counterparts and said, we need help. And so somebody said, well, what if we raise $1 million in 1 week? And everybody went, $1 million in 1 week? 70 years ago, that was money. Still is in my world. But it was huge, and in 1 week, they shipped $1 million to buy things in China to help people recover. So the next year when Taiwan came around, there wasn't a huge disaster, but they said, you know, we could do that once a year and be ready instead of waiting for the disaster to happen. And so from that day on, we have had what we call Week of Compassion. It doesn't mean we're just compassionate for 1 week, obviously, but it means that we are ready because we receive funds over that week to respond to people who are in refugee camps, who experience disaster, who are rebuilding their homes after disaster and their economies. And what we know is that they are very efficient with our money. Last week when Carolyn was here and somebody asked her, what is your overhead? And she said, well, it varies. We have good years and bad years. On our bad years, we spend 8% of our receipts on overhead. They have two full-time employees and several part-time folk in the office, and everything else is done through partners. We don't pick up and say, here's the disaster, we need to spend, we have somebody already there that we're paying. They say, who is responding on the front lines there through the church? And we send money, because the money is more valuable and quicker. And so what happens is then the partners who are already our partners that we trust and we have vetted are ready on the ground with resources that are helping to build that economy. We're not shipping stuff to the place. We are already there. So somebody said, well, what's your best year? She said, well, some years we operate on 2% overhead. 2%. Do you know charities or organizations that operate on a 2 to 8% margin, where all the rest of the money goes straight to where it's spent? It's amazing. Yeah, there are very few places, but yes. But they're few and far between, because they don't spend a lot of money on advertising. Everything that they create pretty much comes in cheap, done by volunteers. And they're here with us as partners right away. A couple years ago, now 2 years ago, in the summers, there were big fires in Central Oregon. And Doug got an email from Veen Nguyen, our director, saying, are you having people affected by the fires I have seen in the news? And Doug said, yes, our John Day congregation is on the front line, and they are opening up their space, and they're taking in people who've been displaced, and they're putting their trailers out on the fairgrounds next door. And V said, well, I can get you a $10,000 solidarity grant right away. And Doug said, that's great. But then V said, but it's the middle of the night, and I'm in China visiting one of our partners, so it might take a day. And within a day, we had $10,000, and that went to John Day, and it was the first money to arrive. We were there first. And the church to this day tells us that that changed their town, because when they were able to have this money, other congregations, other people also chipped in. And now, twice a year, they get together for interfaith and ecumenical worship because they got to be friends when they had to share. And so he said, you not only helped us share in a time of need, but you helped us build our community. That was good news. A few years before that, there was a flood in Vernonia, and the then director, Johnny Ray, called and said, anybody impacted by that big flood I saw? And we said, well, we don't have a congregation right there, but we have people who are responding. And so he sent a $10,000 solidarity grant so that we could take it to the people who were responding. So I called a nice Lutheran woman I knew who works with people in disaster. She works with VOAD, which is Volunteers Organized to Assist in Disaster. And so I called her and I said, who is responding? Where can we be the very most effective? And she said, well, it was Tuesday. She said, can you bring the check by on Thursday? And I thought, why wait 2 days? What is she up to? But I dutifully said, yes, I can come at 2 o'clock and I can bring the check. When I got there, there was a big room full of people. And they were from the county and the city and police and sheriff and one person from FEMA, and they were all there. And I thought, why am I here? And then I figured out what she was up to. Because then she said, well, does anybody have any assets or resources they can put on the table right away? She set me up. So I said, I have $10,000. And everybody turned and went, really? Yeah, I see. We were the first to say money on the table. And then everybody else said, well, we could. She used me. So sometimes your grants loosen other people's generosity and speed them up. That's one of the ways that we are able to operate with such a low margin, because we do not try and do it by ourselves. But also, not only are we first on the scene, we are some of the last people to leave. When the cameras leave to the next disaster, we're still there. It's not flashy, it's not on the news, but we are still there. For instance, there was an earthquake in Ecuador last year where we have partners. And in that time, it happened to be that we had a trip full of regional disciples of Christ from here going to Ecuador. So we called V, and V said, yes, I know about the earthquake. We know that you are partners with Fidice. We know you are going. So they sent money ahead. The director of Fidice, Blanca Puma, who's visited us many times, Blanca then was able to buy from local merchants and help the economy there many, many supplies that could go to the earthquake zone. So when our people got there, they made all these kits with toothpaste and towels and bandages and water and food and granola bars, and they made all these packages, and then Blanca took them. But because we have partners already, we know that the money went directly, and we saw it with our own eyes. And not only that, but continue to see pictures coming back from Ecuador of ways that we are still there and still participating. In fact, 2 weeks ago, the General Church highlights a global ministry once a week. You can get that on your email if you want. And there was a picture there of a bunch of kids, and I recognized their clothes. They're made by a really nice lady in Silverton who buys remnants and makes lots and lots of clothes for children and gives them to me and says, can you get these somewhere? Those went to Ecuador in a suitcase, and there I said, oh, I know those clothes, because we are partners. Now, what motivates me this year is the scripture that was given to us by Week of Compassion, so that all of us would preach the same scriptures these weeks. In the scripture that you may know, and it may be very familiar to you, about the sheep and the goats and dividing, and it's very clear what God is saying in this word through Jesus. If you care for those who are in trouble, you care with me and for me and beside me. If you do not, you are not connected to me. The connection is based in seeing my people the way I see them and treating them with love, even when it's complicated, even when they might be perceived as enemy. If they are in trouble, they are in trouble, and other things fall away. And that is very difficult. It's a very difficult word, because it is, as we just heard before, it's a lot easier to love the people you already love. It's harder when the people in trouble are not necessarily the ones that you love. But the thing about compassion is that it is doing the right thing. But it's not only doing the right thing, it's being the right way, being in communion with Christ. Compassion is not the same as charity. Many people can deliver goods. Compassion is about accompanying, or as they say, accompaniment. It is walking beside and walking with, which is why our theme this year comes from the scripture, when did I see you? You, when did I see you? I'm happy to see other people, but when did I see you, Jesus? Or, when did I know it was you? But what the text says is, when you see your brother and your sister, you do see God. That's how accompaniment works, and you don't leave. You are there. And so there's this wonderful set of posters they have this year with those little dots that say you are here, just like on the maps on your cell phones, that you are here with people, that you are here still in Haiti, as you heard earlier today, and that it is sometimes through suffering that we build endurance, that endurance or perseverance builds character, and then character builds hope. Suffering, endurance, character, and hope does not disappoint us. Hope does not disappoint. And there's two ways to hope in that same text. But because before that really easy to remember part about suffering, endurance, character, and hope, there's a bunch of longer sentences which tell you almost the same thing. Because what they say in those early sentences, the text says that faith leads to peace, which leads to grace, which leads to hope. You can get to hope through suffering, enduring character to hope, or you can get to hope by faith in peace and grace to hope. Some lives have a lot of suffering, and their way to hope is one way. Other lives have an easier run. We have faith that's easier to keep because our circumstances are easier, that builds in us a sense of peace and gratitude and grace, and that can lead us to hope. Both ways to hope are the same destination. And when we work in the Week of Compassion and Accompaniment, we're saying, whether you're coming to this hope from suffering or you're coming to this hope from abundance, we meet here, and we are both here, and we see God. Like the earthquake in Haiti, when many people responded differently, there was still hope. A friend of mine, Glenn Stewart, who was at the time the regional minister of Tennessee, had a real heart for Haiti. He had been there over a dozen times. Every couple of years he would go, and he would be with our partners there, and he would look at their ministries and support them, and sometimes they would build, but mostly they were just being with the people of Haiti to let them know they were not forgotten. It just so happened that the terrible, terrible earthquake that happened a few years ago, he had brought a group of disciples from Tennessee to come with him on a mission trip. They had just gone to the store, they had left their hotel, they just came out of the grocery, which was a three-story building, they were getting in their van, and boom!
That was dramatic.
Everything started shaking. The store they'd just been in collapsed to a pancake. They got in their van and they started driving, and the driver who was from there started driving quickly towards where their housing unit was. When they got there, it also had collapsed. People died in that building that they didn't happen to be in at the moment. They quickly then made a beeline for the driver's family, because they had nowhere to go, and the driver was worried about his family, and they drove. Well, all of their documents, for some of them, they'd left all their documents in the hotel, a pile of rubble. All their things were there, except for what they had on themselves. They thought they were just going to the store, and they left most of their stuff behind. So what happened then was the driver took them to the American embassy. And there were so many people there, and there was so little room, and they were able to lie on the ground and sleep for the night. And they said, we have a lot to do, here's some water, we'll get to you. But what Glenn tells, the story he tells, and I have never seen him tell this story without weeping, and he's not a weeper. He said, you know, as I lay on the ground, I wondered what will happen, and I'm responsible for these people, what have I done? From three different parts of the town. They were right in the middle. They could hear a church service with people singing hymns. The people had gathered in the churches, or what was left of them, and they were singing about hope. And he said, I knew we would be okay. I knew we would be okay. And indeed they were. A few days later, they were able to get out of the country. And we are still there rebuilding in Haiti. You heard the story of the microloans. And now I'd like you to see a picture of what that hope looks like in video.
In Haiti, there's a saying, after mountains, more mountains, and it's true. After an earthquake, then a hurricane where crops are destroyed, homes swept away, loved ones lost. After mountains, more mountains, but here, among the people of Haiti, it's also true that there is hope. And after hope, more hope. Hope in a community that pools its resources to build a school and to pay teachers a living wage. Hope in a small business co-op where women build a bakery, making bread for their families and for sale in the market. Hope in an agricultural co-op that gave Fortaleza a low interest loan so he could receive his farm. Instead of struggling to pay off high interest rates, Fortaleza is able to focus on planting vegetables for his family and trees that will one day reforest a nation. Your gift to Week of Compassion supports communities across Haiti where people are coming together to be there for one another. So come, be a part of the movement. Week of Compassion is here, which means you are here. And when you are here, there is hope. And after hope, more hope.
Every time I watch that, I smile back at them. Because you don't see here defeated people. You see hopeful people. And one of the reasons they can be hopeful is because you have been hopeful with them. One of my dear friends and somebody I know that some of you know, Carol Pure, she is a member at the Murray Hills Christian Church, active in our church camp program over the years. And Carol is the child of a missionary child. Her mother, Miriam, was a child in Congo. And when you asked Miriam why she was born in the Congo, she always would say, in her fun voice, she'd say, "Well, I wanted to be near where my mother was, and that's where she was." I just laughed at that every time she said it. And in her later years, she told that joke many times. But Miriam told Carol all these stories about Congo, where she had grown up for a while. And Carol had never, of course, been there, but the stories were alive in Carol. And so one day, it came across my email that the Christian Church women were taking a trip to Congo and they were looking for people who could go. I got on the phone without even moving to the next email and I said, "Carol, guess what? You're going to Congo." She said, "Well, someday maybe." "No, no, you are going to Congo. It's going to happen. I know how it's going to happen." And so she did. She went to Congo and she came back with her own set of wonderful stories that she went to the hospital where her mother had been born, where she wanted to be with her mother. And Carol, whose mother had died by that time, wanted to be in that place where her mother had been. But one of the stories she came back with that I keep thinking about, even though it's a few years later, she told the story of a woman who walked for 4 days, many miles, in order to meet this group of U.S. women. She went by herself. She was not young. It is a perilous place in some of the places she went through to get there. And finally, when she came, they said, "But why did you do that? Why did you walk 4 days to see us?" And she said, "If I did not come to see you, how would you know that I loved you?" I have not been able to forget this woman who walked for 4 days to make sure that this group of people knew that she loved them. Not that she wanted them to love her, but that she had heard of them and she loved them. And she wanted to say, "I love you," in person. It's not always possible to go in person, which is why we collect funds so that we can go as a group through our assets. But I was lucky, a couple of years ago now, to get a phone call that said, "Somebody in the trip to Cuba has canceled to visit the Cuban Council of Churches." 75 years there's been a Council of Churches in Cuba, and they've invited us to send 2 regional ministers, and one of them can't go. "Can you go?" I said, "What? I'd go to Cuba? I don't know about that." And in 3 weeks, I said, "Whoa, 3 weeks." I didn't even have time to get scared or worried. I just said to Doug, "I can't go to Cuba." He said, "Why can't you go to Cuba?" I said, "I'm not sure." And so he said, "No, you should go to Cuba." So I packed up, not knowing what I would find. But here's what I saw. In our first day at the Council of Churches, I met a group of women who had driven from the other end of Cuba, and that's not as easy as it sounds with the gas shortages and the not very good amount of cars. Beautiful cars, that's true, but not a lot of them. And these women came to tell us about hurricane recovery. And one of the reasons they came is because Week of Compassion, when they ended hurricanes, even though our governments weren't really talking, Week of Compassion still helped people in trouble. So they wanted to say, "We came to tell you that we know the disciples never forgot us." It was a moving story, but then the next afternoon I went to the Pentecostal church with which we have been partners, and when we got there, they had this big party for us, not a lot of physical goods there, but they had a bag of Oreos they shared with us that somehow they had gotten hold of. And they said, "We are so glad you are here because we want to tell you we are glad the disciples never forgot us because we had helped to subsidize a pastor and spouse retreat once a year for them by sending the money through Canada. The disciples never forgot us," he said. Then we went to the seminary where they trained the ministers, and they say, "We are so glad you are here because the disciples, they have never forgotten us because they send a seminary professor once a year to teach our pastor's Old Testament. We are so glad the disciples never forgot us." Now here's the thing. I'm not sure that we know that we never forgot them. I don't know that we know that. I didn't know that. But what I remember from the day that it was World Communion Sunday, the Sunday was there, which was a lovely way of God getting my attention. And when it was time for communion, it's a fairly male, Presbyterian church is fairly male-led leadership. And the pastor said in Spanish, I don't know much, but I knew this, "Is she a pastor?" And they said, "Oh yeah." He said, "Good, she can hold the bread." I thought, holding the bread, I can hold the bread. That can't be that hard. I don't have to talk, this is good. So, it's time for communion, I'm holding the bread, there's a prayer, I'm pretty much following sort of what's going on, and then he said, "You take the bread to that side," said somebody in my ear. It's like, what am I supposed to do? I mean, I've done communion a lot of times in a lot of ways. I am a disciple, once, twice, three times a week, that's me. However, not in Cuba. So he said, "Just take the tray and walk between the rows and give bread to each person on that side." Okay, so I go to that side and I start down the rows with the tray and I look into the eyes of every Cuban person on that side of the church. Deep brown and hazel eyes, some blue eyes. And I look in every set of eyes and I think, we have been taught not to like each other, and yet we are sharing this meal. What is this? This isn't about us anymore. This is about God's love that transcends. And I could see them and they could see me. And every single time I go to the communion table now, I weep. I'm trying to keep traveling so nobody will notice I have this problem. Because when I see you come to the communion table, I see them too. I can't unsee them because I was there. And I'm telling you, they are there. And that they think you have never forgotten them. And they're grateful and they pray for them. And how would we know that if we were not partners? Compassion is about the offering. We have compassion. It's about responding to disaster. But even more, it is a way of saying, I love you, I don't forget you, you do not forget me. We in Christ are one indeed. So the next time you read about a disaster, I can probably bet if it's a global disaster, V's on the phone or on the email. If it's domestic, Carolyn's on the phone. She's getting ready to be your eyes and your ears and your hands. Because in compassion, we do feed the sick and tend the sick and feed the hungry. We dig wells, we welcome refugees. We do what it is that we are called to do so that eternal life not only comes for us personally, but for a world that needs eternal hope. A hope that is sometimes born from suffering to endurance, to character, to hope, and sometimes from faith to peace, to grace, to hope, but the destination is the sun. Hope beyond hope breeds hope that breeds hope that breeds hope. Loving and gracious God, I thank you for the ways that you have tied us together in your church and in your world. Grant us courage each day to live in the hope that you plant in us, to speak the hope, to live the hope, to be that hope, even in times that are complex. Grant us wisdom, grant us courage for the facing of this hour.